A little bit outside of Los Angeles, into the desert, is a particularly jagged rock. But this is no normal jaggy rock, because this jaggy rock is a movie superstar. Thanks to its close proximity to Hollywood and distinctive jaggy features, Vasquez rocks have been used in dozens of movies and TV shows. Their harsh and distinct features make for a particularly easy place to shoot dramatic scenes in old westerns, or to use as the landscape of a barren and hostile alien world. It was here, below one of the many hundreds of Vasquez rocks out there in the galaxy, that a mighty and fierce battle took place. Captain James Tiberius Kirk versus the Gorn. A mighty and fierce battle. Star Trek, the original series, TOS as we call it, is a show that is extremely hard to recommend to anyone in the modern world. It is so extremely a product of the 1960s, both in its cultural values and in its production values. It may be lauded as an extremely progressive show for the time, and it genuinely was, but progressive for the 1960s and progressive for today are not the same thing, and it only takes looking at the women's crew uniforms to see what I mean. Sure, if you watch it now, the image has been remastered in nice crisp HD, but all that does is highlight how cheap and how ridiculous most of it looks. The costuming, the set design, the special effects, and, oh boy, the acting. It is an extremely cheesy watch here in the actual future. If I was trying to get someone actually invested in Star Trek, then I would always tell them to do what I was told to do, and that is start with The Next Generation. Yes, it's got its own set of strange dated issues, but 80s cheese and 60s cheese are very different beasts. TNG still looks like the future, and TOS does not. Because of these factors, TOS holds a very odd place in cultural history. It's one of the most important and most influential pieces of sci-fi media in history, and its legacy extends way beyond modern Star Trek shows. People know Captain Kirk, they know Spock, they know the USS Enterprise, but they know these things as legends, as pop culture icons that have just sort of always existed, equally as iconic as Darth Vader or the Millennium Falcon, but unlike Star Wars, most people have never watched the original. And that is kind of a shame, because underneath all of the 60s sexism and rubber masks, there is a reason that Star Trek hasn't been forgotten to history. It is a fascinating, complex, and ambitious show that was limited by the realities of the era that created it. Today, I seek to prove that to you, using one of the most infamous scenes in Star Trek history. The Gorn Fight. If you've never seen the Gorn fight directly, you've probably at least seen one of the many parodies of the Gorn fight. It's become somewhat of a symbol for 60s era sci-fi, shows where dudes in strange outfits punch big lizard men. What this 2-minute clip is missing, however, is context. Why is Captain Kirk punching the big lizard man? That question unfolds into a much more interesting answer than you might expect. The Gorn fight takes place in an episode called Arena. The Enterprise has been invited to an outpost on the outskirts of Federation space for a fancy dinner to show how prosperous the outpost has become. As soon as they beam down though, it's clear that the messages were fake. The outpost is a battlefield, and the crew immediately come under mortar fire from an unknown enemy. After some dramatic rolling and lots of explosions, the surviving crew are able to escape and go on the offensive, chasing down the enemy ship. In the absence of any other information, Kirk takes this to be an act of war, and he wants to make sure that the enemy ship is destroyed before they can report back to their home base, pushing the ship to its limits to try and catch up with them. However, the chase is halted when they fly through the territory of an unknown third party, one whose technology vastly outmatches either of the two ships. They introduce themselves as the Metrons, and they explain how this is going to go down. They abhor violence and won't tolerate the deaths of everyone involved, but given how both species are clearly so prone to violence, they will set up an arena where the captain of each ship can fight to the death to decide the victor of the conflict. Now, we can punch the Big Lizard. Although, as you now know, he's no ordinary Big Lizard. He's Captain Big Lizard. Now look, I cannot sit here and tell you that the choreography of this intense action sequence is good, actually. It's not. It is, in fact, hilarious. Like, what is this? What did he actually do here? He just sort of slapped the sides of his head and that made the big lizard release him? That doesn't make any sense. It looks like it was made by someone who's never seen a fight before. But this is a perfect example of exactly what I mean when I say that the show is limited by its own production. This is a very interesting and intense fight. Written down, on paper, it's just been executed in a really cheap and cheesy way. The famous part of this fight, This part is actually only the opening gambit of a 20-minute game of cat and mouse. It's supposed to demonstrate to us clearly the strengths and weaknesses of the Gorn. Picture this. Kirk turns to face his opponent, a massive hulking brute, twice his size, covered in scales and a sharp row of teeth protruding from a reptilian snout. He looks at Kirk with death in his eyes. He strikes with tremendous power. One wrong move could be fatal for Kirk, but with his lightning-fast agility, Kirk is able to dodge just in time. Reality doesn't quite match the concept. The guy in the suit clearly can't see very well, if at all, and the mobility of the heavy rubber is very low. As a result, he just sort of vaguely swings in the general direction of Kirk in slow motion. It does fundamentally get the point across. The Gorn is big, strong, and slow. It just looks hilarious. And hey, there is at least one part of this fight scene that is intentionally funny. When they first land, they both go to one of the trees to grab a weapon. Kirk climbs up and struggles to break off a stick, and then turns around to see the Gorn holding a massive branch and just throws his tiny stick away instantly. That's pretty good. The rest of the fight has Kirk running around the desert trying to find a weapon to use against the Gorn. He runs past some bamboo stalks, but they're not strong enough to use as a weapon. He finds sulfur lying on the ground. He finds piles of diamonds lying on the ground, worth a fortune but useless to him at the moment. Then he sees an opportunity and drops a huge boulder on the Gorn. He comes down excitedly to check the kill, but the Gorn still isn't dead, and in his haste to run away, he falls into a trap that we saw the Gorn captain set up, but he's able to escape because the Gorn is just too slow. The Gorn reveals to Kirk that he is capable of talking and explains that they attacked the outpost because it had been built on Gorn territory and they were defending their borders. And he also tells Kirk to give up so they can end this thing already.
I weary of the chase. Wait for me. I shall be merciful and quick.
But good old Jim doesn't give up, and through cinema magic he uses various things he's run past to construct a gun and shoots the Gorn full of diamonds. However, with the Gorn his mercy, he chooses to spare him. And with this act of mercy, the Metrons ponder that maybe there is some hope for humans after all.
By sparing your helpless enemy, who surely would have destroyed you, you demonstrated the advanced trait of mercy. Something we hardly expected. We feel that there may be hope for your kind. Therefore, you will not be destroyed. It would not be civilized.
So that's what happens in the episode. That's the context for why Kirk is punching the big lizard. But with any story, especially an episode of Star Trek, why is only half the question. The other question is, what is the episode about? More than any other Star Trek series, the original series is an intensely allegorical show. Yes, it's a fun spaceship adventure, and it's easy enough to enjoy in that level, but there's always a level beneath that as well, a point or theme that the episode is trying to get across. Why doesn't Kirk kill the Gorn? Understanding why is the key to understanding what this episode is about. Arena is, at the foundational level, about a fight. Kirk v. Lizard. Everything else in the episode is built around that idea. What does it mean to fight and to war? What does it do to people? Where does it end? The Gorn did not just attack the outpost, it was a brutal massacre, which they then used to lure in more Federation ships. They're bad news, and Kirk seems pretty justified in his righteous vengeance quest to take out their ship before they can make it home.
Yet positive proof hasn't. I have all the proof I need on Cestus 3.
Not necessarily, sir. Several possible explanations come.
How can you explain a massacre like that? No, Mr. Spock. The threat is clear and immediate. Invasion.
He doesn't know who attacked the outpost, he doesn't know why they attacked the outpost, he doesn't even know what they look like, he just knows what they did. But that is justification enough to brand them as monsters, right? He's otherizing them because he can conceive of no justifiable reason to commit such an atrocity. Spock and his logical ways are less swayed by that argument, but he does concede that attacking the outpost could be seen as an act of war, and that destroying the ship before they report back could prevent conflict. In this pursuit, however, they run into an unsuspecting third party, the Metrons, who in their enlightened superior world abhor violence. They are literally a deus ex machina, something TOS employs somewhat often, godlike beings who come in to resolve a problem. Though in this case the resolution is only the middle of the story. Kirk's perception of the Gorn as monsters is only helped when he actually sees the Gorn, which he explains with my favourite line in the episode.
Like most humans, I seem to have an instinctive revulsion to reptiles.
Do we? Do most of us have an instinctive revulsion to reptiles? That seems very specific to you, actually. But regardless of that, the point is clear. His ingrained hatred towards something monstrous enforces his idea that the Gorn is a monster, dangerous, and deserving of death. He remains confident in that idea until the Gorn speaks and explains his reasons. An unknown alien threat had built a base in their territory. It could be nothing, or it could be the first step to an invasion. Safer to strike now and make sure the borders are protected. That reason doesn't necessarily excuse their brutality or the fact that they never considered diplomacy at all, but it is a reason, and with a reason, an understanding may eventually come as well. Violence, and specifically revenge, is cyclical. It repeats endlessly if you let it. Kirk set out on this mission for revenge, but had he gotten it, what would have happened next? The Gorn would retaliate, the Federation would retaliate to the retaliation. Soon enough, you're in a bitter, endless cycle of violence where who started what has long since stopped being relevant. The cycle has to be broken somewhere. It can be after 100 deaths or 100,000, but eventually someone has to step forward and choose not to meet violence with violence. Now, an episode of television about how war and violence are bad might not seem that extreme to you. They may, in fact, seem a little bit naive. And that's because you need to understand the cultural context that this episode of Star Trek was released into. Arena aired on the 19th of January 1967, only 2 years after America had fully entered the Vietnam War, and pro-war sentiment in America was assumed. The undercurrent of Star Trek, especially the original series, is optimism. The future, as presented in Star Trek, is one that we can and should aspire to. A society without hunger, without poverty, where everyone works together for the betterment of mankind. While the three main characters are all white dudes, the creators actively fought to have the crew of the Enterprise be as diverse as possible, with three important side characters, Uhura, Sulu, and Chekhov, being African, Chinese, and Russian, respectively. It may seem common now, but in 1967, at the height of the Cold War, having a Russian and an American working together was a massive deal, let alone having a black woman on the bridge of a ship during the civil rights movement. These divisions were incredibly important at the time, but the idea was that in the future we will have moved beyond these things, with the unspoken follow-up sentence being that things right now suck and we should make them better. Captain Kirk is supposed to be inspirational to a mostly white male audience. He's heroic, he's charming, he's a lover, and he's a fighter, which is ironically why the original series had a large female fan base. Fun fact, the term Mary Sue to describe an awesome, all-powerful superwoman who the entire plot revolves around actually originated in a self-insert Star Trek fanfiction parody, by which I mean it was a parody of Star Trek fanfiction and the trends that the author saw in it.
Gee golly gosh, Glorioski!
Thought Mary Sue as she stepped onto the bridge of the Enterprise.
Here I am, the youngest lieutenant in the fleet, only 15 and a half years old.
Captain Kirk came up to her.
Oh, Lieutenant, I love you madly. Will you come to bed with me?
Captain, I'm not that kind of girl.
You're right, and I respect you for it. Here, take over the ship for a minute while I go and get us some coffee.
Mr. Spock came onto the bridge.
What are you doing in the command seat, Lieutenant?
The captain told me to.
Flawlessly logical. I admire your mind.
This was written in 1973, by the way. Who'd have thought that the origin of the incredibly toxic term Mary Sue was actually a pretty funny parody of fanfiction tropes written by a woman? I think I've gotten off topic. The point is that when people saw Captain Kirk refuse to kill the Gorn, despite his prejudice and despite the violence that the Gorn had already committed, when he chooses to end the cycle of violence, the audience is supposed to reflect on their own society and their own lives. Could they be as noble as Captain Kirk in that moment?
No, I won't kill him! Do you hear? You'll have to get your entertainment someplace else!
I'm not trying to imply that Star Trek is a subtle show. The Metron literally appears to congratulate Kirk for being such a good boy. It's a show that wears its heart on its sleeve, and that's what makes it great. And let me tell you, it gets much less subtle than the Gorn fight, especially when Klingons show up. It's worth noting that this approach, at the time, wasn't exactly well received. Star Trek was cancelled after only 3 seasons because of poor ratings, and the series only found its now ubiquity after the fact with syndication when it developed its fan base of housewives and teenage fanfic writers. It was basically the Super Hulock of the 70s when you really think about it. There is a reason that this show caught on, that they were able to come back and make 6 movies, 7 seasons of a new show, 7 seasons of a spin-off of that show, and 7 more seasons of a spin-off of that spin-off, and so on and so forth. These stories and these characters resonate. Yes, it's a fun and silly show about strange aliens and spaceships, but that optimistic view of the future, a vision of the future where we're doing better, not perfect, but better, that's timeless. TOS is not for everyone. If you have a low tolerance for extremely dated things, then you're probably going to bounce right off of it. And there are some genuinely terrible episodes, just completely out of touch racist and sexist stuff. They're fumbling, but they were trying, and that does make this way more watchable than basically any other show from the 60s. This show could have ended up a forgotten relic, like all the other sci-fi shows that aired around this time that you've never heard of, like The Time Tunnel. Star Trek survived, and it survived exactly because Kirk didn't kill that big lizard. He proved that in the future a better outcome was possible, and something to strive for. And that's why now, 50 years later, we can take that big lizard and turn him into a rip-off xenomorph. But that's a story for another time, maybe. Clearly this guy didn't know that all he had to do was spit on Kirk and impregnate him with his eggs. I mean, what an amateur. I actually like Strange New Worlds, but everything they're doing with the Gorn is absolutely bizarre. So that's the story of the infamous Gorn fight. Yes, it's silly. Yes, it spawned infinite Gorn memes. But beneath the surface, it's actually a perfect example of everything that makes Star Trek great.
We're a most promising species, Mr. Spock. As predators go, did you know that?
I've frequently had my doubts.
I don't. Not anymore. And maybe in 1,000 years or so, we'll be able to prove it. Never mind, Mr. Spock. Doesn't make much sense to me either.
Thank you for watching, and a very special thank you to my patrons for supporting the things that I do. If you want to join their ranks, then you can find the link in the description below, as well as a like, comment, a share, and a subscribe if you're feeling Gornerous. If you're looking for Gorn, then I have plenty more Star Trek videos like this one about Picard Season 2 and why it's a hot mess. Or if you're looking for something completely different, then why not have a listen to my podcast where we talk about... Wakey Wines? I don't know what that is.